Let me officially welcome everyone to an ongoing development of conferences, town hall events, led by the International LaRouche organization. We are gathered, this is today, Saturday, August 30th.
Yeah.
This is, we're in Pasadena, California. And the nature of this conference is really coming at a historical period that is everything remarkable. We are on the edge, as Mr. LaRouche said last night in a Friday discussion, of a complete shift in the condition and the future of mankind. His intention, and I think everyone's intention in this room, is that we not only are on the edge of that, but we will accomplish the full development of that process. So what I would like to do is just start off by first welcoming everyone to the event, appreciating your attendance, participation, your questions and discussions, and I hope that we can take from this conference an even more energetic and profound outreach to a lot of the American citizens who are right now, there is not within any American demographic today a sense that there is much life left in the current system. And many of them, given an opportunity for these ideas, will respond. We are at what Mr. LaRouche described 4 or 5 years ago as a Shelley moment. And so the idea is to bring this kind of collaboration together of ideas, of policies, of a strategic picture, and take that out to our fellow Americans. Because at this point, the critical factor in accomplishing this full transformation of the planet, while minimizing what is right now the excessive loss of human life. I mean, for decades, we've had an opportunity to lead mankind in this direction as a country. And over these decades, we have wasted many lives within our own country and globally. And that process must end. An urgency as dedicated to the dignity and preciousness of every individual creative human life must be the basis of immediate political action. And we should take that away from this conference with an enriched sense. So let me just present then part of what, a kind of an introduction into what we're facing in the world today. And then on our first panel today, we're going to have Mr. Phil Rubinstein and then Ms. Laney Rubinstein presenting a much fuller picture from a philosophical, an international, and an economic perspective where the world has been and where the world is going. But there are a few developments I just want to present just to kind of situate the context. These last 6 weeks have been a demonstration of the noetic potential of the human mind and of the human species. Within these last 6 weeks, it seems as if 6 years may have gone by. The level and rate of development on a global scale, the transformations of nations from a dark age perspective into a perspective of development, of a future orientation, and situating not just in terms of development, not just of economic projects, not just of infrastructure, but a sense of the significance of their nation, a significance of their people, of their young people, in the scope of humanity, in the scope of civilization. For example, obviously the six-week period is marked and initiated by what was culminated in Brazil in the middle of July by the BRICS nations, and I'm sure many people who are listening are here. We also have a call that people are listening to live that couldn't make it today. But many people here and listening are aware that BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, consolidated what had been in discussion for nearly a decade, which was a new economic system. A system not based on looting, a system not based on extraction of resources, or exploitation of cheap labor, but a system dedicated to the development of their population, mutually, in shared collaboration. And in the middle of July of this year, that was consolidated. Since that time, we have a complete shift in nations. Take, for example, Bolivia. The president, Evo Morales, was a cocaine rogue. Not necessarily the best perspective for a president of a nation to have a background in growing cocaine. And yet, under a shift, not because he didn't have a dedication to his people, but just not necessarily the qualifications to leading a modern nation. But because of the development of the BRICS, because of a change in the, you could say, the field, the economic, international economic field of our planet, there was a defense of the right to sovereignty. There was a defense of the right to development. You see this with Russia, Russia's defense of national sovereignty, a defense of Syria's sovereignty, really a defense of Ukraine's sovereignty, because what's being done to Ukraine is an absolute violation of the principle of sovereignty. You look at China. China is a complete defense of the right to any nation to develop. Any nation in Africa. Has that promise been made by European nations or the United States? For centuries, not at all. Except maybe under a few presidents like Roosevelt or John Kennedy. For nations in South America. And nations like Russia, China, India, really probably the three of the cornerstone of the BRICS, along with Brazil, the largest nation in South America, South Africa, greatest potential for development in the continent of Africa, have now created a defense of sovereignty and a defense of development. How do we know this? Nicaragua, or let me stick with the case of Bolivia. So Bolivia, here's the president, a former cocaine grower. They've now announced not just a commitment to a full-scale development of the nuclear fuel site and of nuclear energy, and the development of the science, technology, and manufacturing of that. They've situated in the scope of what it is to be part of the human species. They grasp not just the engineering facets or accounting facets of what engineering or what nuclear power provides in terms of electricity and so on. They recognize it, that the basis of policy for a human species and for a human society, for a nation, is based on how do we participate and contribute to the overall development of the human species. And they made that conscious. They made that public. That this is part of man's development over the course of 20,000 years. Emerging out of caves, out of a sense of fear, into the developments of principles of fire, of chemistry, of agriculture, and that process is still continuing, because if we are successful, and I'll tell you we're not yet successful, and I'll go into specifics on where the threat and risk still lie, but if we are successful, generations 100 and 200 years from now will look back on us and see a dark age, or a mini dark age. They will see backwardness. They will see archaic technologies. They will see technologies which have potential used in the most mundane and banal means. And they'll wonder how we even survived. And we're now seeing policy shaped from the standpoint that that future generation is going to exist, and we're going to bring it into existence. But this isn't the United States. This isn't Germany. This is Bolivia. This is Nicaragua. Nicaragua is now developing. The same company that designed the Three Gorges Dam is now designing and developing the largest canal from the Atlantic to the Pacific, which will bring in an economic renaissance into the entire Caribbean basin, much larger and deeper than the Panama Canal. Take a nation like Egypt. Egypt in the last 2 years has suffered the overthrow of Mubarak. General economic despair, levels of youth unemployment, 40, 50, 60% throughout the entire North Africa Maghreb region. We saw revolutions in Tunisia. We saw what was done in Libya. We saw the upheaval in Egypt. Young people had no future. They had no food. You have graduates in electrical engineering working at fruit carts because there was no jobs and no future. Egypt creates a revolution. They overthrow Mubarak. And what comes into power is an even more fascist regime. The Muslim Brotherhood, the Morsi administration. One of Morsi's major acts was to essentially privatize under presidential control the Suez Canal area, and to provide that to the global financial institutions, to the British Empire. They were going to hand the Suez back to the direct destruction of their own nation. So of course, under those circumstances, under a fascist regime, the Egyptians have the commitment and the courage to say, we're going back to the streets, and we're not going to accept it. There's a certain dignity there, a certain commitment, we're going to make this work, a certain perseverance that's necessary if you really want to save your nation. If you really want representation and self-government, you actually have to fight for it. The Egyptians have. The military responded. They overthrew the Muslim Brotherhood, a fascist regime, explicitly fascist. And now, under this new presidency, al-Sisi, they are now offering employment to every unemployed 45 years old or younger to come work on now an expanded Suez Canal project. Tunnels, industrial areas, expanding the canal. They're developing nuclear power in the western regions, developing new cities. They're giving hope and imagination, a sense of science and creativity to their future generations. A nation that just had two revolutions was on the verge of total economic destruction under the yoke of a British Empire since the 1880s. And they're now emerging as a major nation. An interesting side note, when the rest of the African presidents came to meet with President Obama to discuss the basketball game and his jump shot, President al-Sisi of Egypt met with President Putin of Russia to discuss potential trade agreements on food production and trade between those nations, clearly in alignment with the BRICS. Thailand, a nation also critical to this process, was very clear about their commitment. Also a nation who has had upheaval after upheaval after upheaval. The only stability in Thailand has been a monarchy, which is not, you could say, simply not committed to their population's development. Again, the military, a national institution, stepped in, not always, in this case, in a very positive direction. And they are now initiating direct collaboration with China. And there's now on the table a project called the Krok Canal, a major development through the Isthmus of Thailand, which will transform that area into a major industrial and scientific area. This is fascinating. More fascinating is what we see from nations like China, what they've accomplished. And you'll hear more in depth on that particular perspective in the first panel. We are on the verge of something remarkable. As Mr. LaRouche said, what's happening in China is the greatest revolution in human history. We're at a point now where the renaissance we intend to create, that Mr. LaRouche has initiated, is not simply in one nation or in a geographical region such as the Mediterranean or just in East Asia. We are now talking about a renaissance of the human species. It shouldn't then be surprising that since Mr. LaRouche has initiated this specific conception over 45 years ago, nearly 50 years ago, as a social and political commitment of himself and his organization, that nations like Thailand and the Krok Canal, where this organization made a series of presentations specifically on that project throughout the 1980s, that are involved in Egypt for decades around projects such as the development and advancement of the Suez Canal, the idea of advancing and developing a more significant canal in the Isthmus of Central America, have been projects that this organization and Mr. LaRouche and his wife, how is that LaRouche, have fought for over 30, 40 years as specific projects with conferences held internationally in Egypt, Thailand, Argentina, South America, Japan, China, Europe, and the United States. So it should be our commitment to fulfill this type of development orientation. The problem we face is the risk of total chaos. Because this empire, this British empire, which is now dying, has only one option left, and that is chaos. You see it in Israel-Palestine. You see it probably the most clearly in areas of Iraq and Syria, this ISIL grouping, clearly funded and created as a monster, as an intended, uncontrollable monster, much like the Nazis and Hitler were, by the same empire creation. The same is true with the drug cartels in Mexico and Central and South America. Both of these organizations have been explicitly supported by the Obama administration and by the international financial institutions. This is a British Empire operation in its entirety. At the same time, you have the risk right now of a complete dissolution of the international financial system. It can go. It can go on Tuesday. It can go in September. It can go in October. Many cases, the financial markets, the financial systems have, to the senses, blown in October. In reality, and as I'm sure you'll hear more in the first presentation this afternoon, this system has already gone. It has already died. What you have now is a system of sticks and duct tape, a Potemkin village left of an economic system. And the government's trying to support this what's left of their, or what appears to be a system. Is it really an economic system any longer? Or is it just really a death trap? The governments trying to support this are collapsing. And France collapsed. You're about to see the collapse in Germany. Merkel's government is a complete failure. Because of her actions, she is leading Germany down the pathway of conflict and confrontation with Russia. Not a very good history with that. Hasn't worked very well in the last century. These nations and governments are collapsing. So is ours. And what's necessary today is to revive the true American spirit, the true American political outlook. And we have that. We have it in the United States with Mr. LaRouche, this organization, and our collaborators in Congress, in the states, and in the American people. This is going to be a fight. As we discussed on the Thursday night call that we have for activists, there's a lot of preparation and planning that went into World War II. A lot of logistics. Franklin Roosevelt, because of his foresight, developed the infrastructure, the machining, the manufacturing, the electricity, the science, the food production, the infrastructure, to actually have a war machine that produced a tank, you know, for every canteen. And for every American, you know, Jeep, the Germans had a pair of boots. But there came a time when soldiers and American citizens and their allies found themselves on the beaches of Normandy. There was no longer going to be any more preparation. You were now in a fight. A fight you could win and must win. And if won, would change the course of the war and the course of human history. And that is the political fight we are now engaged in the United States. And if we win this year, we do culminate and consolidate what potentially is the greatest renaissance in human history. And that's what we're here to discuss today. So again, I appreciate your attendance and participation. I expect this afternoon to be incredibly provocative and fun. I look forward to your questions and discussions. So on that note, I'd like to present the keynote speaker of this afternoon, Mr. Phil Rubinstein, a longtime collaborator of Mr. LaRouche and a leader of his organization. So, Phil.
me say, you know, I'm going to go through a few things. Mike has given you a background as to where we stand. I might throw a few points out there. Lane is going to go through, in particular, the element of the sort of collaborative basis amongst nations, and particularly in the area of physical economy. That's the basis for looking at this as a different renaissance, both in quality and in quantity. Because we're talking about a development in culture as well as in economics that would cover, you know, at present, at least half the globe's population. China, India, Russia, Brazil, a good chunk of South and Central America, in India. So we're talking about billions of people, which of course makes it, on the one hand, an enormous task, but on the other hand, a task which can't be done at this point without. And we should have some time before the break for some Q&A, and there'll be time later on. Hopefully, schedule it that way. Now, let me just read. Lynn said in response to a question about launching an impeachment of Obama and so forth. Lynn says, we have to understand the seriousness of our situation. This is not something which is bad for some of us. This is not something which is unpleasant. This is tragic. Tragic in the full meaning of the term tragic. That unless we can solve the problem, which is the tragic problem, we will not come out of this alive. Because what is happening? As we know, especially in the western states of the United States, especially west of the Mississippi, the situation of the citizens of the United States is at this moment implicitly hopeless. There are marginal exceptions to that hopelessness. For example, some people in San Francisco are more fortunate than in Los Angeles, and more fortunate than those in Texas. More fortunate than other parts of the prairie states and so forth. But under the present conditions, their chances are worse than poor. Therefore, unless we in the United States are taking action which is action of change, which provides a means for getting us out from under the present situation of the people of the United States, the people of the western states of the United States are for the most part condemned to the worst kinds of outcome. This is reality. We have to change the course of history now. No more of the past. We have to begin to move. How? Well, let's take a look at something we can do something about, all this evil that we're dealing with. What could we do about it? Well, we can do almost anything we want. What has to happen is to have get a revolutionary change in terms of the organization of the application of the idea of funds in order to create a U.S. economy. And the only way to look at this is to lift the U.S. economy out of a casket. We're beyond the point of arguing about this. Many Americans cling to the idea that either no matter how bad it is here, we've got it better than other people. Or alternately, well, it is bad, but we're just gonna have to figure out how to survive. And in that survival, you often find an absolutely idolatrous view of money. Now, I'm not a religious person, but there are some interesting insights that, you know, that come from mythology, legend. Sometimes they have a truth to them, including some of the insights of the New Testament and the stranger insights of the Old Testament. But the idea that monetary valuation, monetary systems, that human beings exist because of money. You know, where was the primeval hoard of money that began the economies? Somehow, since everything is based on the marketplace and the value of money, and I mean literally the value of money, the value of currency, or the value of financial instruments, which are essentially bets on the value of other financial instruments. People are very confused about this idea of a derivative. And it's true that most even economists or accountants can't exactly explain it to you, because they like to have certain idea of legitimacy. They don't want to tell you quite what it really is. But it's nothing more than a short-term bet. They call it risk management, but the basic idea is you have a stock, let's say it has a certain value, or a group of stocks have a certain value. And then you bet, or let's say an index, you're making a bet that in the future, that group of stocks will have a certain value. If it's above a certain value, you might win. If it's below a certain value, you might lose. And you pile one of these on top, there's no limit to it. Credit default swaps. So you swap a credit that you have in case it defaults, and somebody else buys it at a certain value, betting on the value of what the defaulted loans might be. Now, you have to figure this is a huge portion of the US economy today. Trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions of financial instruments in monetary value. Mind-boggling numbers. You know, I always tell the joke, because back in the 60s, there was a guy named Everett Dirksen, who was a senator from Illinois, and he had a wonderful, strange, rumbling baritone voice, like which I'm not about to try to imitate. He was one of the, you know, the war horses of the Senate, a power broker, a pragmatic soul. And he, you know, he once had the famous comment, a billion here, a billion there, sooner or later you're talking about real money. Now, these days, that would be nickels and dimes. These days, a billion here and a billion there, you're not talking about real money. You're talking about a tiny, pathetic amount. The estimate of the nominal value of derivatives in the system is 2 quadrillion. Now, to give you, I don't know how to get across the magnitude. It's 2 followed by 15 zeros, or it's a million billion, okay? So it's big. But of course, what's the actual product in the US economy? Next to nothing. We no longer produce a damn thing. We are one of the most unproductive nations relative to monetary value in the world. We are bankrupt. That's the truth about the American banking system. If you think you have money, you don't. Not in the sense that it represents any value. Your pensions are going to be, look at what's happened to pensions already in the last go-round. What's going to happen in the next go-round? We spoke to a banker in Austria the other day who said, there's going to be blood in the streets. They don't know how valueless this entire system is. Look at the precariousness of life in the United States. A massive portion, and I mean, I'm talking 60, 70, 80% of the American population lives in, what I mean by precarious, is you're maybe one decline in paper value from being broke. You're maybe a couple of paychecks from being homeless. You have to wonder if you get sick or anybody in this family gets sick, can you pay for it? Or are you going to have to say, well, no, we're going to pay that, make the house payment as opposed to the health payment? You're beginning to accept arguments that say, well, you know, if you're 65 years old and you got a hip displacement, maybe it's not worth spending the money. You know, you can limp along, maybe you'll die a little earlier, but you've already put in 65, 70 years, not bad. A long time ago, that would have been a long lifespan. What's your quality of life at this point? You have a child, we have a good example of this. You have a child with Down syndrome, one of the leading British scientists, so-called, a guy named Richard Dawkins, said, well, a woman asked the question, I was, they told me my child is going to have Down syndrome, and what should I do? And Dawkins said, well, if you know that, you're obliged to abort, because that child effectively is going to be a burden on society. And this is one of the most prominent philosophical scientific thinkers in Great Britain. He simply represents a tradition. Bertrand Russell, John Stuart Mill, Jeremy Bentham. This is what you're dealing with. Frankly, any American, I mean US, North American, who thinks that the British are the source of the American Republic, is frankly the victim of one of the greatest psychological warfare frauds in the history of mankind. We are not based on the British model. We are not based on an imperial model. And yet many Americans think that we walk in the footsteps of the British Empire. One good example, by the way, is Teddy Roosevelt. Teddy Roosevelt was a self-proclaimed imperialist. So, you know, this is what we're dealing with. The European banking system, the transatlantic, London and Wall Street, is completely bankrupt. You look at the United States, the population, less than 10% of the population is involved in producing a product, either an engineering product, a bridge, a highway, a commodity that's of some use, agriculture, less than 10%. And a good deal of that 10%, while it may produce a product, that product is often, for example, computer systems. Most computer systems are used to no good purpose. Now, computers can be useful as an adjunct to a productive process. But if a computer is used so that a kid can play computer games, what you're probably producing is the next generation of high school shooters. There isn't a single one, it is an interesting thing to look at. I know of no case of one of these mass shooting incidents in schools where the shooter was not a computer addict. And I would, if somebody has an example, it would be interesting to hear. But Connecticut, Colorado, every one of these kids was a computer addict. Violent computer games. Now I think when we look at this idea of tragic, and the computer thing is something I'll reference in a couple of minutes, but if we look at this idea of tragic, I think Lyndon LaRouche, who basically has forecast since the 1960s at least, the overall decline of the Western financial system, that if we moved into a speculative system, which is what it is since 1971, with the end of the Bretton Woods system, the end of the fixed exchange rate system, the move increasingly to the so-called deregulated free market system, we have been in an increasingly dead-end speculative system, of which you only keep alive by imposing a certain imperial control on the populations of the world. In other words, by the dominance of the dollar, you're scraping value out of South America, Africa, Asia, by looting the population. What I simply need cheap labor. What's the idea of cheap labor? They produce more for you than you pay for it. You don't give them value in exchange so that they can build up their own technologies. In fact, you rule it out. You won't sell them dual-use technologies because they might make some military gain out of it. So the idea is keep progress from everybody else, make them sell to you what they have at lowered prices, and the difference is what you use to prop up the phony value in your system. And nobody's going to change that. The only argument that people have is that's just the human nature. That's just the way it is. Well, that's not the way it is. That's not human nature. What's the idea that human nature is greed? Well, I'll tell you what it is. Take Thomas Hobbes. The life of man in nature is nasty, mean, brutish, and short. Therefore, we have government to protect us from the evil of our next door neighbors. To make sure that your space is okay and their space is okay. And government should do nothing else. And how says Hobbes, do you enforce that kind of social contract? You can't trust anybody else. Somebody or something has to have absolute power. So he called his book The Leviathan. And what was the Leviathan? The Leviathan was the emperor, who was not bound by any part of the social contract and could therefore impose his will on everyone else who's in the contract. That's the whole idea of small government in the United States. This country wasn't built on small government. This country was built as a unified nation state, a republic. That's what Franklin wanted. Read the Federalist Papers. Two-thirds of the Federalist Papers were written by Hamilton. Now, is Hamilton a small government man? Most of the Constitution was written by Hamilton. Hamilton was Washington's number one ally. There's a mythology about Jefferson and Madison and so on and so forth. But who was Washington's ally? Who attacked Washington? Jefferson and Madison and Adams. Now, what do we mean then by tragedy? Well, let's take what Lynn said, the western parts of the United States. Here's a good example. In one sense, how are the western parts of the United States built? Here's a good example of small government idiocy. The western parts of the United States would not exist if it weren't for the central federal government. Who built the transcontinental railroads? Abe Lincoln. During the Civil War, and then completed afterwards. Who fought, when Lincoln needed to fight the Civil War, Wall Street said we won't lend, well, they're gonna lend the money at exorbitant rates with all kinds of limitations and a gold backing, which we didn't have. So what did Lincoln do? Lincoln set up the greenback system, which was a credit system. And, you know, people say to Lynn, what do you mean by a credit system? It's not complicated. A credit system means the federal government issues credits through a national banking system, and currency is only authorized in response to that credit system. And the value of the currency is determined by the issuance of the credit and not the other way around. And so you have major infrastructure and scientific development projects, and they are the front runner of the economy. And so you can have private enterprise involved in the form of carrying out elements of the project. people bid on parts of the project and so on and so forth. And you have local banking, which then administers the contracts and the letters of credit to the contractors. That's what we did to build the railroad. That's what Roosevelt did in the Depression. Roosevelt, the only problem Roosevelt had was the Federal Reserve, and he sort of, for a short period of time, outflanked the Federal Reserve. That's how, most of what you had. Now, how was the West built? Who built the Hoover Dam? Well, you know, it's called the Hoover Dam because of Herbert Hoover, but it was really completed and hooked into the whole Colorado system by Roosevelt. Who built the Grand Coulee Dam? A friend, Pat Rucker, just told me today, it's still the fourth largest electricity producer in the world. Who produced the water management system that took a desert called California and turned it into an agricultural marvel? Well, Roosevelt and then later Pat Brown. You think you could support 40 million people in the state of California on small government? It's foolishness. It's tragic. This is where you get smallness. You know, I'm paying my taxes. Well, if the taxes are being wasted, it's true. But that's a question of what is the idea of a republic? And the idea of a republic is an educated citizen. There's no point. And look, I'll tell you the truth. People like Hamilton and Franklin knew this. There's no point in having an electoral system if you have people voting who don't know their ass from their elbow. It doesn't work. It's not going to work. You actually have a certain amount of serious debate about ideas that are led by the leadership that forms itself in the population. It's not a matter of a party system. The party system is garbage. The loyalty to the Republican Party, you're loyal to John Boehner? What? So you're a golf fan. Okay, that's one thing. That means probably you're a little bit in the upper crust because I know what golf clubs cost. I know what golf balls cost. When I was a kid, golf balls cost $1.25 for three. Top line. Top flight golf balls. I know because we used to steal them and sell them to people. Because, you know, if you could sell three for 50 cents, they would buy them, you know. That was my relationship to golf. Okay? But Boehner's a golfer. Obama's a lunatic golfer. If a nuclear war started, he would probably play an extra 18. So, what's the tragedy? Well, look, what we're now faced with, and this is somewhat public. We've discussed this amongst the LaRouche science team and so on and so forth for a while. But you're sitting in the middle of a mega drought. And Pat will go through this someday. This is probably, right now, we're in as much, by some calculations, as the 10th or 14th year of a drought. And I've been coming out here long enough, I remember the last wet year, which was about a decade ago. We're getting 3 and 5 inches a year in rain in Los Angeles County. A year. I was in New Jersey in July, August. We had 4 and 5/8 inches of rain in one day. Now, this is the biggest agricultural state in the country. We produce in California 30 to 40% of what's called produce, fruits and vegetables. We're one of the biggest rice exporters around, partly because Americans don't eat much rice. We're actually trying to export rice to China. Some people thought that was like selling ice to Eskimos, but it's not true. Okay? The Chinese are looking for more sources of rice and so on and so forth. So what we're facing the loss of the western parts of the United States. There was a recent study by some California scientists that said we are probably in the middle of another 10 years of drought. And therefore, it qualifies as a mega drought. Now, these are droughts that we have documented over, you know, thousands of year period, where periodically this area goes through 30, 50, even 100 years of massive drought. What does this mean? First of all, it means food for the country. For example, I like these ironies, for example, we have Michelle Obama. Why? That's another question, but we have her. Now, she, of course, is making a big deal about obesity. You know, she wants these kids to get thin and so on. You know, obesity probably is some people's problem. Where does the obesity problem actually come from? We have a phenomenon in the United States where you find poor people are among the people who have the greatest obesity problem. Why is that? Well, because they have fast food, which is relatively speaking cheap, and they also need to go that way because they're hanging on to two or three different jobs. You know, the real story in the United States is the working poor. More than half the people on food stamps have jobs that pay nothing. They pay garbage. Most people who have gone through the recent crisis, if they're re-employed, they're re-employed at about 50 to 60% of their previous wage. They've gone from 40,000 to 50,000 a year to 28 or 25 or even 20. So what do? They eat fast food. What's the point of fast food? It's got a lot of fat, it's got a lot of sodium, it's got a lot of junk in it, because that's sort of what makes you want to eat it. It fills you up. What would these people eat if they had a decent diet? Well, they'd eat vegetables and fruits and, you know, some meat. Meat is a good thing for meat. So what Michelle Obama is trying to do is insane. You can't change it unless you change the way people are able to access health, healthy foods, transportation, so on and so forth. She's actually killing these kids. Maybe she's killing them with kindness, but I doubt it. So we're knocking out the produce in the United States. This state has 40 million people. One of the people studying this in a rather nonchalant way said, well, you know, maybe we'll just have to have an out-migration. That's what's happened historically to the human species when you run into these droughts. People just migrate. They just have to go elsewhere. So we're going to ship out 20 million people. How many? Where do they go? Well, we had this phenomenon. You had the Okies in the 1930s. But remember, the country only had 120 million people at the time. We now have 320 million people. And it's not just California. It's Texas. It's Arizona, New Mexico, parts of Colorado, Idaho, Eastern Washington. 35% of this country is in extreme drought. Now, this is where you get tragic, because Americans don't think of these things anymore. They don't think of being productive. They think it's just going to be there. You know, there's the old joke. You know, where does breakfast come from? Vons. They grow the boxes with cereal on the shelves, right? We don't have to worry about farmers. They're passé. Just go shopping. You don't have enough wages? Here's a credit card. Here's a debit card. How did I get in all that debt? And then you get people who say, one of my old favorite stories is, you know, the subprime mortgage market. Because my favorite story was a story in the LA Times, actually, back about 2008. where, you know, they were giving the example of what the mortgage-backed security problem was. And they had a Mexican immigrant, I think a legal Mexican, a Mexican immigrant, who was a landscaper, you know, and he had, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 kids and his wife. And so they get a mortgage for $750,000 for a house. Now, he was an immigrant, you know, his English was broken. So, and I know the way these families work, because I've run into it. The idea is, you know, they got this 18-year-old, he's going to get a job, the daughter's going to get a job, the son-in-law's going to get a job. So they're going to have 8 people live in the house, and they're going to take 7 salaries and put it together to pay the house. Okay, this is all over the place. Now, the line in the article was somewhat, well, maybe these guys, they faked out the mortgage, the banker. Now, you got to really ask yourself, are you going to buy that story? A Mexican immigrant with a 6 or 8 person family who's a landscaper is going to con a mortgage banker about his income? The guy can barely speak English. But didn't a lot of Americans believe that story? They were like, oh, the problem is people who lied about their incomes, who faked out the mortgage bankers. Jamie Dimon was outflanked by a bunch of Mexican immigrants. And that caused the crash. It's absurd. It's beyond, it's absurd. You only believe something like that because you want to believe it. Because you don't want to have to deal with Jamie Dimon. Or with Wall Street, or with any of the bigger issues. You don't want to deal with the drought. Tell people, you know, you can only water your lawn Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays. Pretty soon it'll be you can only drink water on Monday. Take a shower once a month. Learn to live together. Now, this is a serious problem. We don't have a solution to it. Why? Because we don't have the science being done. We don't have the investment in nuclear research. We don't have a power grid. In California, this poor state, which was once a frontier of the United States, we have not added a single watt of energy to the California energy grid since 1990. Now, the population has grown by over 10 million since then, maybe even 15 million. Now, supposedly, we accomplished this with conservation. No, we accomplished this by lowering the living standards. We're destroying an entire population, and it's not uncharacteristic. Now, what's the point of tragedy? People misunderstand tragedy. They'll often say, I mean, in terms of what was real classical tragedy all about? What was Aeschylus about? What was Shakespeare about? Why do people like Shakespeare, and I think this is it, and Schiller and Aeschylus, they're always talking about kings and queens and nobility and generals. It's not much, you know, and if you have this kind of average people in it, they're kind of comedians. They're kind of fools or comic relief. I mean, the classic case is Falstaff. But there's others. You have King Lear. Prince Hamlet, Macbeth, or a character like Othello, who was, of course, the great general for the Venetians. What are they? What is the real issue here? Is it just that they're flawed characters? That's the other way. One way is tragic is, you know, somebody's best friend passes away. We call that a tragedy. It's a tragic. I mean, some of the ways we use tragedy is ridiculous, you know? Like you have some football player who busts his knee up after 13 years and $50 million, and you say, well, that's tragic. It's not exactly tragic. It might be a sad thing for the person involved. But it doesn't rise to the level of tragedy. Tragedy is when the leadership of a culture, of a civilization, of a great nation, fails to live up to the tasks of the day because they're trapped by the existing beliefs. Or by their own personal life. In one sense, the classic case of this that LaRouche, as I talked about, is Hamlet was a swashbuckler. He was a young, maybe a little overweight. There's all kinds of funny things in it if you read every line in Shakespeare. But he was a fool. This was the Prince of Denmark, which at that point was a substantial power, probably back about the 13th century. Actually, Hamlet was born there on the island of
Peninsula.
Jutland. Now, in what's now Denmark. Many of Shakespeare moved the site to Elsinore, which is across the straits from Sweden. But Hamlet, he comes back. His father tells him, take it as you might. The ghost tells him, "Your uncle killed me." And your uncle then wedded your mother, my wife. It's your task to avenge me. It's a frightening scene, actually. So, what happens to Hamlet? His entire life now is driven by avenging his father and venting his spleen at his mother. And of course, he manages to fail to do what he really should have done, which is to have replaced Claudius. Denmark was in deep trouble. Denmark was falling apart. There's something rotten in Denmark. It had lousy leadership. Claudius was a faith. And who was Hamlet? He's supposed to be the successor. He was the next in line. But he failed because he was dominated by what he thought was his personal mission, his own feelings, and often forgotten, he was very popular with the people of Denmark. They staged demonstrations for him. But he couldn't do it. And of course, the classic scene is Claudius in the chapel. And Hamlet has the moment, whether it's to do away with Claudius. He's caught him. He's already confessed. He goes to the chapel because the play is the thing that will catch the conscience of the king, and it did. And then Hamlet raises the knife. He's about to do what he was supposed to have done. And what happens? He says, "Well, if I kill Claudius now while he's praying, he'll go to heaven." And that pisses me off. So I'm not going to do it. I got to wait till he's going to go to hell. So Denmark is lost. The scene that's often cut out at the end of the play, because throughout the play, the Norwegians are back and forth, Fortinbras and Fortinbras' father, because there had been a battle and so on and so forth. So who really comes on at the end of the play? Not Horatio. Horatio says, "This is awful, look at all the dead bodies and so on and so forth. My job is to tell people of this awful scene." Because he was Hamlet's good buddy. But then comes Fortinbras the younger, and he says, "Look, Denmark is finished because of this. And let's hope people don't repeat this." What did Lear do? He feels a little grumpy in his old age. It's not a big mystery. And he wants to basically play some game with his daughters about who loves him. And the kingdom is lost. By the end of the play, the kingdom is lost. What Shakespeare is writing about is culture, civilization, nations, countries, states. Now, since he was writing in the end of the 16th century, he wasn't going to be writing about democracies. There were no democracies. There were no republics. The European nations were ruled essentially by monarchies or oligarchies. And so these are affairs of state. These are affairs that determine the future of the human species. Shakespeare is actually writing as part of a political movement to try to organize Queen Elizabeth and others to save the nation of England, which is otherwise going to hell, and ultimately becomes the most brutal empire of the 18th, 19th, 20th century. But remember, that comes from the Dutch. Right? The Dutch conquer England at the end of the 17th century, and they're already a significant empire. And they bring together the Dutch and the British, and they form what we know as the British East Indies Company, and ultimately the British Empire. When does the British Empire form? At the founding of the United States. Basically, Franklin and Washington decide in 1763 that there's no hope of being accommodated within the British Empire. And at that point, they plan to split from the mother country. At the same time, the faction of the British East Indies Company, Lord Shelburne and so forth, are rising to power in Great Britain. And they're forming the empire. The threat to the empire was the United States. Remember, this is also about the time that they capture India. So India is the jewel of the empire. And soon this empire spreads to Africa and so on and so forth. The biggest problem was the failure in the United States of the British Empire. They try again in 1812. A much misunderstood, a lot of Americans say, well, we didn't have to do this. Baloney. They were impressing American sailors. Then they backed the South in the Civil War. And then they maneuvered to get a certain number of Anglophile presidents. Teddy Roosevelt's family was Confederate, or at least half of them was Confederate. His mother was a dyed-in-the-wool Confederate. She was sending care packages to Confederate soldiers from New York State during the Civil War. His uncles were leaders in the development of the Confederate Navy, and one uncle was the head of Confederate intelligence. His father was pro-Union, but he wouldn't join the Union Army because his wife wouldn't let him. That's our great swashbuckling lunatic president, Teddy Roosevelt. The guy was a psychopath. You know the charge of San Juan Hill? That was his great claim to fame. The greatest loss of American forces in the invasion of Cuba was Teddy Roosevelt's group up San Juan Hill. And he did it because he wanted the Congressional Medal of Honor. And he got it. It's a tragedy that we think people like that were any damn good. That this is part of the culture of the United States. If you think that's a joke, think about John McCain, who's a great fan of Teddy Roosevelt. This is his image of leadership. This country is suffering from a great tragedy in somewhat different circumstances. Because we are a republic. So that it's true that affairs of state involve the citizen. But it involves a citizenry that has a concept of leadership. Remember what Franklin said, I'll give you a republic if you can keep it. There's nothing that guarantees a republic. There's no form. There's no grouping of tactics that are going to give you a republic. It's a funny thing, and I don't want to go off on too many tangents, but you know, there was a group of dramatists in the United States, which was different than Europe. You know, people like Miller and Odets and O'Neill. And part of what they were doing, they thought they could develop a concept of tragedy around the average man, the average guy, you know, struggling to make his way through life. You know, read some of these things like, you know, The Death of a Salesman or View from the Bridge. And it's about average guys, a salesman, a longshoreman, and the tragedy of their life. Well, they're interesting dramas, but they're not tragedies. Because these guys had no idea that they represented were supposed to represent a quality of leadership for the country. You want tragedy? Abraham Lincoln and the Confederacy. You want a certain kind of tragedy? The failure to develop the science, the productivity needed to deal with the kind of crisis that this drought means. That's a tragedy. The idea that we believe in climate change and environmentalism, and that leaders capitulate to cutting back on science and development. What do we have? I'll tell you a tragedy. What happened to NASA? It barely exists. What happened to U.S. nuclear capability? I'm talking about peaceful nukes. We're cutting back. We're shutting, look at California. I get it backwards, but we shut down San Onofre, and we're going to shut down Diablo Canyon, or it might be the other way around. Okay? This was the heart of scientific development after World War II. JPL, Aerospace, Caltech, Berkeley, Lawrence Livermore. This wasn't Hollywood. Jeez, my God. The idea that tragedy, the idea that our greatest product is Hollywood, we call that intellectual patent rights? You really want to call what we now say is no longer pornography, but mainstream film, and you call that our greatest product? That's a tragedy. The idea that our presidents go to Hollywood to raise money so that they can become a president and they can't break from that? Now there might be the basis for something that approximates a tragedy. We worship financial brokers. We think great Warren Buffett is a genius. This is a country that used to think Thomas Edison was a genius. The Wright brothers did something remarkable. Now we worship Warren Buffett. Isn't it a great irony of Buffett, who was the great spokesman for yes, we should pay taxes, he's now involved in one of these inverted mergers where he had a lot of money in Wendy's or Burger King. Burger King. And Burger King is buying out a donut business in Canada. And that gives them the right to move their headquarters to Canada where their taxes are half. That's a hero. But the fact of the matter is, not that Buffett is so bad, it's that Americans are so backward. They become small, petty. And we worship money. So we have a drought in the West that we can't deal with because we don't want to spend the money. We don't have any money. We have to create the money to spend, but not in the form of a monetary system, in the form of a credit system. Now, one of the things that's changed just in the last period, months, is that a year ago, there was nothing going on in the world that was going to turn the world as a whole from this situation. You know, I don't have time to document it, but you know, we had starvation, we had near nuclear war on the Ukraine, Russia, starting in the Ukraine case, which is a whole story unto itself. We have this insanity in the Middle East where we have created ISIS. Face it. We backed them in Syria. We funded them through Saudi Arabia and Qatar. There's no doubt about it. Now we're going to fight them in Iraq and support them in Syria. You can't do that. We're going to send our jet fighters to the Iraq-Syria border. They're going to stop at the border. You know, there's a little sign there that says stop if you're a jet fighter. And we're going to launch from, you know, at a distance, cruise missiles and so on and so forth, and turn around, and this is how we're going to destroy ISIS, because we don't want to destroy the people who are fighting Assad. That's our policy as of the moment, except that I guess Obama on Thursday said, we really don't have any policy, I was too busy golfing and we haven't figured it out yet. That is sort of what he said. Okay, that's a, see, the idea that we can't impeach Obama, that we can't remove Boehner, that's a tragedy. But it's a tragedy in the entire population. The fact that we accede to a gutless leadership is a tragedy. The real tragic figures are the American citizens. Now you can say, well, what about our, but you're supposed to guide this, the Congress. This is a republic, not a democracy. It's a republic. And that's why this is a tragedy, and you see it writ large in California, in the Western states, that wouldn't exist if it wasn't for science, that wouldn't exist if it wasn't for development, that wouldn't exist if it wasn't for increasing populations and increasing capability. Think of the idea of population control. We don't like it. Why? More people are good for the planet and they're good for the human species. We're better off than we were when we were running around at the edge of the ice age trying to track down mammoths or something. You know, we can live the kind of life we lived then. Go look at some of the Bushmen in Africa. You know, they run for 10, 15, 20 miles and spear an antelope. And it's pretty impressive, certainly for most of us physically. But that's how, the reason we have more human beings is because we can produce the conditions that improve the life of Americans, of the world population. And we begin to explore the universe as a whole. That's another story. But what's been the history of the human species? Scientific development, which is discovery of principles of the universe. Creative scientific discovery, which allows us to have power over more and more of the universe. We control electricity. We never did that. You know how long we controlled electricity? 200 years at best. Now we know that human beings have been on the planet for, in the present form, probably a couple hundred thousand years. In terms of a genus, maybe, you know, 2 million years. Maybe a little more. We've had electricity for 200 years. How long have we had nuclear power? 100 years. Less. We could have fusion. It means breakthroughs in science. And what LaRouche has been putting forward is that this is the distinction in Western civilization between Promethean man and Zeusian man. What's Promethean man? The bringer of fire, the bringer of knowledge, the bringer of discovery, of creativity, the realization of the human mind. What's Zeus? The oligarch. And these are real characters in human history in some form or other. They're not just legends. They're not just myths. This has been the issue. A republic is based on the idea of a Promethean concept of mankind. I'll end, because I don't want to, on the point. You know, the United States, what used to irritate Europeans, and particularly the British, about Americans, is they were brash, they were can-do, you know, they may not have known every theory, but they could do something. When we were fighting, building up to the fight in World War II, you know, the Europeans were on the British were on the front line after they had backed Hitler, they ended up fighting, that's another story. But Roosevelt said, build 5,000 airplanes. They built 50,000 airplanes. We produced something like 400,000 airplanes during World War II. We were the can-do nation. Now, what are we like now? So, you know, Kennedy said, go to the moon. We went to the moon. We can quibble about this and that, but we went to the moon. We were ready to go to Mars. We were ready to send exploration out. Now what do we have? We can't even go to the space station. We have no major operations going. We have no plans. We can't do it. We can't afford it. We can't do it. Can we deal with the drought? We can't deal with the drought. Can we create fusion power? No, it's too much. It might not happen. Can we impeach Obama? No, it won't work. You know, they control the Senate. Can't do it. Can we get somebody? Boehner. Let's do something. No, that won't work. Practical. We become very practical people. We know everything that won't work. We're brilliant. You know, you got to win the election this way, you got to do that, you got to capitulate on this. You know, Abe Lincoln said, you know, slavery is bad. He won with 40% of the vote. Nobody in the South voted for him. People try to say, well, Lincoln, you know, man, he was really pro-slavery. If he was so pro-slavery, tell me why nobody in the Confederacy voted for him. Zero. He wasn't even on the ballot in the Confederacy. Nobody wrote his name in. But you know, we can't do anything. So we should just admit it. We've become the can't-do nation. So we're just going to capitulate. The drought's going to knock a few people off. We're going to give up farming. The Chinese are going into space. They're going to mine helium-3 on the moon. They're going to develop fusion power. They're going to Mars. The Russians are going to join them. The Indians are going to join them. Africa's going to try to hitch a ride. And we can't do it. But we're pissed off that the Chinese are now becoming more powerful than we are. So we should go to war. We should confront them. We should contain them. We should control their development. That we might be willing to do. That's a tragedy. We're going to lose this nation. And don't think it's not possible. We have to join what is a real renaissance with the greatest conception, including a conception of creativity, that you're seeing in China. And that Lynn directly, Helga directly, Lainey will go into some of this, have played a role. So I'm going to leave it at that. This is Lainey.